Hello everyone! Like I said in my previous video, today's game between Magnus Carlsen and Ho Yifan could be an interesting one, and it seems I was not wrong. Like I said again in my previous video, Ho Yifan had a pretty bad start to this tournament. Out of the first six rounds, she had only two draws, one against Karakin and one against Kramnik. And after six tough games, there's nothing worse than facing world champion Magnus Carlsen with the black pieces. But that's chess, they are there to enjoy it. So let's see this game. Carlsen has the white pieces and he opens the game with c4. And whether Ho Yifan is the strongest woman player or not, it's that's debatable, I guess. But she is more than 100 ELO points higher rated than second place Zhu Wenjun of China and third place Anna Muzychuk of Ukraine. So pretty much making her the strongest woman chess player on the planet. And I personally think she is the strongest. But let's get back to this game. So c4 by Carlsen, the English opening, and we have e6, the Agincourt defense to the English. Knight to c3, d5, d4, knight to f6, c captures on d5, knight captures on d5, and e3. C5 by Yifan, bishop to d3, and now a series of exchanges in the center. C captures on d4, e captures on d4, and now knight captures on c3. B captures on c3, and queen to c7. Developing the queen, also eyeing that pawn on c3. Carlsen defends it, bishop to d2, and knight to d7. And we have queen to g4. Carlsen plays queen to g4 with a prepared variation, probably preventing Yifan from developing the bishop on f8. As the queen is harassing that pawn on g7, so knight to f6 first, getting the knight on a more useful square, and here Carlsen plays queen to g3. He didn't have to go for a queen trade, but that's Carlsen's style. This is move 11, and he doesn't mind exchanging queens and going straight into the endgame. So queen captures, h captures on g3, and there wasn't really a lot of moves here to play other than to exchange queens. You could go for something like queen to c6 just for the, you know, sole reason not to exchange queens, or queen to d6 maybe, but unfortunately you can't play bishop to d6 because still that pawn on g7 would be hanging. So queen captures on g3, h captures on g3, and bishop to d6. So it's hard to say who's better here. I mean, both players have the bishop pair. You can see that Yifan has only two pawn islands, while Carlsen has three pawn islands, which is definitely in black's favor, but Carlsen does have the open h-file for the rook. So something for everyone. Knight to f3, b6, now preparing to develop the light square bishop, and a4. As Carlsen has a lonely a-pawn, he would definitely like to push a5 and exchange it to create a weakness on Yifan's queen side. Bishop to b7 and the immediate a5 by Carlsen. King to e7, we have king to e2, connecting rooks and also adding more protection to the bishop on d3, since Yifan could have some ideas maybe of playing bishop to e4. So knight to e4 by Yifan, bishop to e1, not allowing Yifan to grab the bishop pair. h6, we have c4 now, making room for the bishop on c3 when the knight moves from e4. Knight to f6 and bishop to c3 now. We have bishop to e4, now that king to e2 move does look very useful, and rook h to b1 by Carlsen. Of course, preparing to capture and then recapture with the other rook. We have bishop captures on d3 with check, king captures, and knight to d7. Here, knight to d2 by Carlsen, preparing to push this pawn to f4. This will seriously limit the activity of this bishop on d6. We have rook h to d8 and knight to e4 now. Bishop to c7 and bishop to b4 check. King to e8 here. And king to e8 here is pretty much the only move. Knight to c5 does seem like an interesting idea. After all, the d-pawn is pinned. But it's just not a good move. I mean, you just lose a pawn. White can capture, and after black captures, bishop captures on c5 with check, you lose a pawn. So after bishop to b4, check, king to e8, and we have f4 now. And it's very hard to find a move here for Yifan. For example, if you play something like knight to f6 to maybe relieve some pressure, activate your rook on d8 and something, it doesn't work because you can simply capture it after g captures on f6, rook to h1, and there's really no way to defend the h-pawn, and the other pawns on the king side will fall soon. So after f4, rook a to c8 by Yifan, and now we have a captures on b6. A captures on b6 and rook to a7. And here, knight to b8. And this was the move Carlsen had to calculate before he decided to even play rook to a7. Now Yifan is threatening knight to c6. For example, if Carlsen decided to double up on the a-file, rook to a1, then this knight to c6 move wins the game for Yifan. The rook is attacked on a7, the bishop is attacked on b4, and the pawn on d4 is attacked twice, from the knight and the rook on d8. So you either have to play bishop to c3, to defend the d4 pawn, but then you lose the exchange on a7, or you have to play something like rook to a4 to defend the bishop, but then you lose the d4 pawn. So this would be winning for Yifan. But Carlsen had everything sorted out here. After this knight to b8 move, Carlsen prepared this rook captures on c7. He gives up the exchange, but will really get a lot in return. Rook captures, and now comes knight to d6 check. You don't want to go on a dark square, since there's a bishop on b4, then Carlsen can even win back the rook with a move like knight to b5 check. So king to d7, have to go for the light square, and now knight captures on f7, grabbing a pawn. Rook d to c8, as the rook was attacked, and now knight to e5 check. King to e8, and bishop to d6, attacking the rook. And the rook really doesn't have anywhere to go. It can go to b7 or a7. If you play rook to a7, then simply rook captures pawn on b6. So Yifan decides to go for rook to b7, but now c5. Going for the pawn on c5, as you can't capture, the rook will hang on b7. So knight to c6 by Yifan, and now rook captures on b6. Rook captures and c captures on b6. And now already you can see Carlsen has a very nice passed pawn on b6. This bishop is very nice on d6, guarding the queening square, the b8 square. So Yifan is up the exchange, but a very unpleasant position for her. So knight to d8, and we have bishop to c7 here, locking that rook out of the game. So quickly, rook to a8, you have to activate it. King to c4, improving the position of the king, of course. Knight to b7, and king to b5 now, getting deeper into the position. Rook to a2, now Yifan has to use the rook. She has to try and grab as many of the backwards pawn Carlsen has, but g4. King to e7, and now g3, not allowing the rook to capture it. We have knight to d6 check, bishop captures, king captures, and knight to c4 check now. King to d7, you have to keep the king close to be able to go king c8 and defend against this b-pawn queening. King to c5, we have rook to c2 now, pinning the knight. F5, e captures on f5, g captures on f5, and rook to f2, attacking the f5 pawn, so knight to d6, defending it. And now rook to g2, going for the g3 pawn. We have knight to e4, now attacking, defending the g3 pawn, and rook to b2 now, not allowing this passed pawn to be pushed even further. We have g4 now, rook to b1, knight to d2. And this was a very intense moment in the game, as Carlsen does have some options here, but actually knight to d2 is the only move that actually allows him to continue the game with a better position, and it's actually the winning move. And Carlsen played this like immediately. So knight to d2, attacking the rook with a tempo, but then the knight will come to some more active squares where he can harass the king and help with promotion of the b-pawn. Rook to h1, and this is with the idea of pushing h5. So if Carlsen continued with something like knight to e4, then Yifan could in fact push h5. For example, f6, g captures, knight captures, and since it was check, king e6, and now knight captures on h5. And you do have three pawns for the exchange, but it's hard to say. It's probably still winning, but there would be some drawing chances here. So instead, after rook to h1, Carlsen doesn't go for knight e4 or c4. He goes for the immediate d5, and this is, in fact, the strongest move that gives white the winning advantage. H5 by Yifan, and this isn't the best move, but it's very hard to find a good move here. Probably best would be something like rook to d1, attacking the knight, and after knight c4, pinning it with rook to c1. But that's, again, a very hard position for Yifan. She decided to go for h5, and here d6 is played. Carlsen ignores any threats on the king side, and d6 is the strongest move, and Carlsen again plays it immediately. We have king to c8, and now g captures on h5. Rook captures on h5, and king to c6. Now, as you can see, Carlsen has a passed b pawn and a passed d pawn. It's very unpleasant. King to b8, and knight to e4 now. Not rushing anything, since there are some terrible threats of knight to c5 followed by knight to d7. There, you know, even threats of checkmate are here. We have rook captures on f5, and here Carlsen played knight to c5, and in this position Ho Yifan resigned the game. Doesn't really matter what you play. If you decide to push your own pawn, for example g5, this loses immediately. Knight d7 check, king has to move, b7 check, king a7, promoting to a queen with b8, this comes with check, king a6, and now either queen to a8 checkmate or queen to b6, this is all checkmate. And even after knight c5, if you don't decide to do it, if you go for something like rook to f7, this is a bit more resilient, but in the end it doesn't matter. For example, b7, king to a7, not allowing knight a6 to come with check and promoting the next move. So d7 now, rook checks, king to c7, and now rook to f8. There's really nothing to play here. Knight e6 attacking the rook and also guarding d8, rook b8, and now d8 queen. Rook captures with check, king c6, and it's all over. Now with a queen and a knight against the rook, black really doesn't have anything to hope for here. So after this knight to c5 move, Ho Yifan resigned the game, and Carlsen is now on 4.5 points out of 7, still 1 point behind Shakhriyar Mamedyarov, who achieved a very nice victory today against Wei Yi. I will try to show that game as well. Mamedyarov is now in first place, alone, I believe, with 5.5 points out of 7. So quite a beast. I wanted to say that you can, I don't know if you follow the live feed of the Tata Steel Chess Tournament or any of their social media, but you can win a chessboard signed by all the participants of the Tata Steel Chess Tournament. You just have to predict a winner on their Facebook page. So, you know, if you would like a chance to win a chessboard signed by all the players, you know, do check it out. I also did my prediction. If I win, I will give away the board on my channel. So yeah. That's the game. I do hope you enjoyed it. As usual, you can check two of my previous videos here. They will both be videos from the Tata Steel Chess Tournament. Thank you all for watching, and I will see you soon, probably with another video from the Tata Steel Chess Tournament 2018.